Okay, good morning, everyone, and thanks for choosing my session. Okay, a quick raise of hand. How many people here use Jenkins? Okay, so I'm in the good room, and we can begin. So hello, everyone. My name is Jonathann. I live in Tel Aviv in Israel, and I am originally from a town in south of France called Marseille. And nowadays, I'm leading the DevOps effort at Ravello Systems. What I do when I am not working as a DevOps engineer or not spending time with my friends and family, I like to play guitar. This is my actual electric guitar, Gibson Les Paul, and I'm very proud of it. And I am taking pictures. I love photography. So what is Ravello Systems? Ravello Systems makes it possible to run any workload, any x86 workload, x64 workload, on the public cloud, and that with a zero migration, conversion, rebuild effort. To do so, we developed a high-performance nested hypervisor, overlay networking, and an application-centric management, all that accessible through a pay-per-use SaaS platform. In other simpler words, we are providing data center as a service on the public cloud. So a few metrics about Ravello Systems. We are a startup company. We have 30 developers. We have 4 development teams. And we are maintaining and developing 7 major projects. We don't have a formal development methodology. We are using some kind of a Kanban-like development methodology that is accessed on doing a lot of small and quick releases. So for us, continuous integration is a must. This is a part of our technological stack. As you can see, it is very diversified. We are developing from C kernel level to Java backend to frontend in Angular and HTML5. So what are we going to talk about today? I will start with what we won't be talking about. I won't explain to you what is CI and why you or your company should use Jenkins or CI methodology. You have to understand that at Ravello Systems, from the early days, we were early adopters of Jenkins and of CIs. The problem being that throughout the years, our CI environment became very fat, very hard to maintain and to scale. And we came to the point that we really needed to do a rebuild phase of that environment. So like Jay-Z famously said, I got 99 problems, but the build ain't one. As I said earlier, we already have a CI pipeline. So what should you do when you have a CI pipeline that is running and you need to create a new one? What is the question that you should ask yourself? What should I keep? What should I break? What should I improve? And in order to find the solution to those questions, we've gone to our developer and we ask them, OK, guys, what can we do to make your life easier when you use Jenkins? What we receive from them is a list of problems. And what we will go over right now are those problems and what did we how did we decide to solve them. So first of all, jobs leftover. When you are running a lot of jobs and you are not taking care of the job leftovers, the first thing that will happen is that it will cause a full disk. And we all know too well that when the disk is full on a slave, every job that will run on it will fail. So our first straightforward answer to this problem was to use a plugin called Workspace Cleanup. What this plugin does, it just removes the workspace from the disk of the slave as soon as the job is over. But then what do you do when you are using technologies that are not file-based, but are rather cache-based, like Maven or NPM? In such a situation, cleaning the workspace from the disk won't be enough. So what we need is a new clean environment for every job. Another problem we had was a very need for a better resource distribution. Let's have a look at this situation. From one side, we have the backend team. And for the sake of their example, let's say that they have 3 slaves with 1 executor on each slave. And the other side, we have the front-end team with only 1 slave and 1 executor. The blue thing that you can see below are jobs of the backend team that are waiting to run. So let's start to run them. And now we arrive to the situation when we are waiting for the next available executor. On the other side, we have the front-end team slave that is empty. Nothing is running on it. And maybe we thought, OK, so maybe we can create some kind of common pool of resources from all the team and start to use them all together. So this is what we did. And then we kept running our back-end team jobs. But then arrived a front-end team jobs. And when we are comparing the backend team job and the front-end team job, the backend team is a very fat job that is using a lot of resources, that is taking a lot of time to run. And the front-end team job is a very easy one, quick one. In 1 minute, it is over. So right now, we have a situation where the front-end team will have to wait even several hours before receiving an executor to run. And usually, in this situation, the reaction of the front-end team leader will look like something like that. And that is very understandable. So we definitely need a better resource distribution. We need a rapid and scalable way to spawn dynamic environments. And in order to solve this issue, we decided to use the technology that is started to be very known among the Jenkins community that is called Docker. So how do we use Docker in Jenkins? First of all, we are using the Jenkins Docker plugin. We decided to create a dedicated Docker host for each team, for each of our development team. And the host machine capabilities will be a function of what is the team size and what is the team requirement. But in the end, we decided to put all the images of all the containers on every host on every team. So like that, if we say we have a situation that a team is going through a very stressed period and it needs to use resources from other teams, it can be really easily done. And now we solve two issues. We solve the job leftover issue, because first of all, each time that we will run a job, when the job will begin, it will talk to the Jenkins Docker plugin. The Jenkins Docker plugin will create a container, the job will run on the container, and as soon as the job is over, the Jenkins Docker plugin will destroy the container. So right now, we have definitely dynamic slaves. We don't have any more static slaves, so we don't have to take care of the environment. And of course, we solve the resource distribution problem. Another problem we had was a security problem. As I said earlier, we are a startup company, so we have no Active Directory and we don't have any need for Active Directory. It means that when we started to use Jenkins, we decided to use Jenkins' own database to manage users and passwords. The problem being that when you use Jenkins' own database to manage user and password, you are using a static mechanism to authenticate. And the problem with static mechanism to authenticate is that people can pass between them users and password. And then you see yourself, you see Jim that will start to use Dave's account and will run jobs on Dave's name, and we don't want such a thing. Another problem we had is, what do you do when you have an employee that leaves the company? If you don't remember to go into Jenkins and then to remove the account will stay there forever. And what about this situation? I have a company, the same guy that every week is coming and asking me to reset his password to Jenkins. And let's be honest, we don't have time for that. We have more urgent matter to take care of. So what we need is a third-party dynamic authentication mechanism. And because at Ravello Systems, we are using Google Apps to manage your mails and calendar, we decided to use the Jenkins Google login. And with that, we are using the Matrix Authorization Strategy plugin. And what does it give us, the use of both plugins? First of all, now we have the Google SSO mechanism to connect to Jenkins. And with the Matrix Authorization Strategy, we can manage our user at the group level, which is very nice. And now, thanks to the Google SSO, we only have a two-factor authentication for everyone that is using Jenkins. If we want, we can even open our Jenkins to the world. Okay, now I have another question. How many of you use script in their jobs? Of course, everyone is using script in Jenkins because Jenkins makes it really easier to patch some script inside the job. The problem being that usually when you are writing a script in a job in Jenkins, at the beginning the script is very little, a few lines, and with the time, the scripts get bigger and bigger and hard to maintain and all. So our first problem with that, it's really hard to maintain because usually, how do we take care of scripts that are running in Jenkins? We are writing them in Notepad++, and then we do copy-paste, and we are always forgetting one character here, one character there, and then you do the copy-paste in the white box of Jenkins. And this is not a really good way to manage that. because it can be really easily broken. And what happened when sometimes the script in your job stopped working? You will stop to run after the people of your team and ask, who touched the script? The script was running very well a few minutes ago, and right now, it doesn't even start. So the solution we decided to implement in Ravello System is, first of all, to put all your Jenkins scripts in revision control. But now we have another problem. Because by default, when Jenkins is running, running a job, it only lets you use one SCM. So in the case that you are running a job that doesn't need to go to a revision control to pull some code, you can pull your script easily. But what can you do in the case that, let's say, by example, you are running a build job? The first step that you need to do is to pull your code from revision control, and later on, it means that you would not be able to run your script because your script is in revision control. So to solve this issue, there is a plugin that is called Jenkins Multiple SCM plugin. And thanks to this plugin, now we have the opportunity to pull several SCM parallelly, and it helped us to implement this solution. Okay, so right now we add a versioning of the script that are running in the job. But what about the job itself? Because a few months ago, it was always happening to me that I have a job in Jenkins and I am altering the configuration of the job, and then the job breaks, and now I need to remember how was the configuration before I changed it. So we discovered that there is a Jenkins plugin that is called Job Config History. And what Job Config History does, first of all, it saves you all the old configuration of the jobs. It lets you make a diff between two configurations of the same job. And let's say that in the case you discover that the old configuration is better than your new one, you can always revert the job configuration from this plugin. And but OK, so now we have all our configuration of the jobs, and the problem is that they are saved on the master itself. If we lose the master, what happens? So there is another plugin that is called Jenkins SCM Sync Configuration Plugin. And what this last one does, it saves your whole Jenkins configuration in revision control. So it means that your config.xml, the configuration files of each of your users, the configuration file of each of your jobs, all that will be saved in revision control. In our case, we decided to save it in GitHub. Another need we discover is a need to jobs to share data between them. Let's have a look at this situation. From one side, we have a backend job. And for the sake of the example, let's say that it is a parameterized build with only two parameters. The first parameters will be the backend version that we will testing. The other one will be the frontend version that we will check the integration between the backend and the frontend. And on the other side, we have a front-end job that receives exactly the same parameters, but with different values. We can ask from the back-end engineer to remember what will be the front-end stable version. He doesn't know and he doesn't care to. And this is the same thing from the front-end engineer. So what we need at the end is some kind of an interface or service that will store data, and that data will be accessible from all the jobs. So we decided to use Jenkins global string variables. But there is only one problem with such global variable string in Jenkins, is that those global variables cannot be altered from a job. It means that if right now I am running a CI pipeline, and the CI pipeline finishes successfully, I have no way at the end of the CI pipeline, using a shell script or a Python script, to change the value of the global variable. Yeah, I cannot do them in the regular Jenkins script, but I can if I know how to use Groovy. So I wrote this little script, and this little script receives two parameters. The first parameter is the name of the global variables, and the second parameter is the value. So let's say if I am running this script on a global variable that is already existing, it will change the value of the already existing global variables. If I am running the script on a global variable that doesn't exist, it will create me a new one. And that is making my life way easier. Don't worry, guys, after that, I will give you the link to the script. I put it in Gist, so it's all good. So now what can I do? I can keep a global parameter for each product's stable version. I have a global parameter for my backend stable version. I have a global parameter for my frontend stable version. And I can have all the other job uses these global variables. And at the end of a CI pipeline, let's say that now I've built and run CI on my backend product, at the end, I can run the Groovy script. And from the second that my CI pipeline finished successfully, all the other jobs will know that from now on, if they want to run the backend stable version, they will have the latest one. So this is a GIST link, and there is a QR code if you guys want, if you need the script. OK, so before digging further, I need to explain to you how CI at Ravello Systems is working. So this is how it looks like. First of all, we are running our build, and we are running a unit test on the code. After that, we are creating an environment. Then we are deploying the code that we just built on this environment. We are running some tests. And if it all goes well, we just need to stop the environments. We decided to add some a few steps in the middle. First of all, we are using Artifactory's GFrog product. And what is happening is that after we are running our build and unit test, we are shipping the created artifact to Artifactory. Then later on, when we will need to deploy our code, we will just use the HTTP API of Artifactory to pull the created artifact, and we will be able to deploy it. Another step we added is a log collection step. Usually, when you are running CI and the CI fails, the first response from your engineer or your developers will be to connect to the environment to check the logs. OK, let's see what didn't work. And usually, when you are using dynamic environments, the problem with that is after that, the whole pipeline will be over, the engineer needs to restart the environment, to recreate an environment, and all that costs money. So because we decide, first of all, because we want to save money, and because we discover that the only thing usually that the engineer will do is going to check the logs, so we decided before stopping the environments, we have a script that will connect to each of the virtual machine of our environments, will push the logs file to S3, and after that, whenever he wants, the developer will be able to download the log zip file and then investigate what did not go well in the running of the test. But OK, this is a typical CI pipeline. According to me, in the CI pipeline, the whole thing is not the build, it's not to deploy the code, and it's not running some tests. The very challenging part in a CI pipeline is to create the environment. And as I said earlier, at Ravello Systems, we are providing data center as a service. So it means that for us, creating a dynamic environment is what we do best. So at Ravello Systems, we decided to test Ravello Systems with Ravello Systems. So what did we do in Ravello Systems? This is the interface. This is how the Ravello Systems interface looks like. It really looks like it's a drag and drop interface, and it's really easy to use. So we created an identical twin of our backend services. As you can see, we have the database. Under that, we have an ornet queue. We have a VNC servers. We have exactly this is an identical twin of our backend service, and using Ravello Python SDK or Maven plugin, we can, at the beginning of our CI pipeline, create dynamic environment on demand. And that was really helping us on our road to CI. So OK, let's sum up what we had until now. We have our Jenkins slaves that are dynamically created thanks to Docker. We have our environment, our integration test environment, that are now up thanks to Ravello. So we have all the pieces we need for our new CI pipeline to be up and running. There is just one thing that is missing is, OK, we have a CI pipeline. How do we present the CI pipeline to the developers? Because in the end, they will be the ones that will be using the CI pipeline. So we better do something that will be easy to use for them. So what is the best way to be sure that what we will do will serve them good? we've gone to the developer and we ask them, OK, what do you guys want? And I know that usually this is not a good question to ask a developer. What do you guys want? Because usually they never know what they want. And I have more than one story that a developer came to me and asked me, OK, I need exactly an environment that looks like that with this plugin and this integration. And you take some time, you develop the environment, you develop the infrastructure, you deliver it to the developers. And after a few days, they say, you know what? We found a solution of our own, and we don't need that, so thank you. But I discovered that if you are several teams, and you go to each one of the team and you ask them, what do you guys want? And each team will give you exactly the same requirement. So usually, this requirement is what they need. And when I've gone to my team, the requirement that I receive from them is, OK, what we need is some kind of a black box with a button that you push the button, and the black box is creating an environment, deploying some code in the environment, running some tests, and after that it is over, it will shut down the environment. So I told them, OK, guys, that is exactly what we had in the past. So I only have to take my old job from my old environment and copy it to the new Jenkins environment. But then they told me, no, we got a twist. It's not that easy. We want to be able sometime just to run the create part of the environment. We want to be able sometime to only do the deploy, or only create deploy, or only create deploy run. They wanted a very dynamic and modular solution. So my first straightforward answer was, OK, so I will create them a job that do only create, then a job that only do create and deploy, then a job that only do create, deploy, and run, et cetera, et cetera. But I'm a lazy engineer. And I don't like to create a lot of jobs and don't like to maintain a lot of jobs. So I had to find a solution that needed no duplication. So we decided to create a job that we called CDRS for create, deploy, run, and stop. And this CDRS, when you are running it, it receives a lot of parameters. And all the parameters can have can thinking about of all the possible scenarios. And in the end, using the multi-job plugin, because one of the great advantages of a multi-job plugin is that it has a conditional step. So using multi-job plugin, we are really able to create some kind of conditional pipeline like this. And this is what did the trick for us. OK, so right now, we have our CI environment, our developers are using it, and everybody is beautiful at Ravello System World. But OK, so what do I do now when I want to add another job, when I want to change an existing job? How can I do it, first of all, without breaking it, without telling my developers to stop using this job? Nowadays, at Ravello System, we add, every time we have at least 10 instances of CDRS that are running. If I go to my developer and tell them, OK, guys, from this hour to this hour, you cannot use CDRS because I'm working on it, it's like that I'm telling them, OK, guys, from this hour, Jenkins will be down. And Jenkins down means that continuous integration is down, and it means that the product will not be ready on time, and it has a lot of consequences, as you can understand. So what we need is a parallel Jenkins environment that will be almost identical to our regular Jenkins environment. And on this new, on this dynamic environment, on this parallel environment, I'll be able to test my changes on the job and then to take to the conclusion if the newly created job is ready for my production environment or not. So what did we decide to do? First of all, we created a Jenkins environment blueprint on Ravello System. Then using Ansible, if you remember, guys, a few slides before, I talked about the plugin SCM sync configuration that was saving our whole Jenkins configuration on revision control. Yeah. So what does it mean? It means that right now we have a real-time backup of our Jenkins environment. So why not use this real-time backup? So using Ansible, I do a git clone to my revision control. And now I have the opportunity using Ansible to push the configuration from my revision control on the newly created Jenkins environment. And after that, I will just do some minor changes, like changing the production keys to be sure that my parallel environment will not deploy something on my production server and all. And on this dynamically created environment, I will just run regular jobs, and I will see if the jobs that I'm running on them are working. If they are failing, it means that my changes are not good. And all that, of course, all this pipeline will be orchestrated for my production Jenkins environment. If I give you an example, it looks like that. I have my Jenkins script, the script that I'm running on the Jenkins jobs. And of course, I am saving this script on revision control. So OK, I do a change on the script. This change will be listened by a Jenkins job. This Jenkins job will just discover that there is a change, so it will start a pipeline. And what this pipeline will do, it will create a dynamic Jenkins environment. It will run jobs on this dynamically created Jenkins environment. And if it all goes well, it will stop the dynamically created environment. So in a certain way, we are using Jenkins on Jenkins. And when I talk to people and I present them this idea, I received all kinds of names. I received nested Jenkins, but my preferred one, my favorite one, is Jenkinsception. OK, so this is how the Jenkins sandbox look like. We have Jenkins master. We have a Docker host. And because I said earlier that when we are using Dockers, every Docker host team have all the images of all the other teams. So in my sandbox, I only need one Docker host to be able to do that. And the Artifactory server, because it will be a good way for us to manage when we are running the jobs, the created artifact and all. So now, if we are comparing what our old Jenkins environment looked like and the new one, about the number of jobs, we dropped from 137 jobs to 56 jobs. And those 56 jobs are doing exactly the same and are giving the same solution that the 137 were giving. In our old Jenkins, we had 10 static slaves. In our new Jenkins, we have no static slaves. The number of slaves can vary from 0 to 15. And it's really nice to see sometime. And if we are looking at, let's say I took by example our backend job build and test duration. And when I'm talking about the build and test, I'm talking about the whole CI pipeline. In our old Jenkins, it took 70 minutes. In the new one, it is taking 43 minutes. So at the end, we have APR developers. So some final takeaway so you guys can take home with you. First of all, always ask your developer how to make their life easier. Because there are customers, and we always want happy customers. This is what we need. Don't be afraid to break things. By breaking things, you need to fix them. And when you fix them, you learn new stuff. And this is the only real way in our domain to improve. You break things, you fix it, you use it, and you repeat. Culture is very important when you are using Jenkins and when you are in the DevOps domain. So keep talking to other people. I am myself always asking to other DevOps engineers, other people from other companies that I am meeting, how do you guys do? What technology do you use? What jobs do you have? How many jobs? What is how many deployments are you doing? And this is really important to share the knowledge in our community. If you guys have Twitter, there is a Twitter account called Jenkins Release. And each time that there is a new plugin that is going on the market, this account will give you a notification on it. And it can be nice because if someday you are discovering that there is a bug in a plugin that you are using, this little guy will tell you when there is a new version of the plugin. And one last thing, if you guys know, there is a Twitter account called DevOps Reaction that is a very funny Twitter account. By example, it gives you some kind of a title and GIF image under it. And this is an example of a project handover that they are giving. And yeah, it really looked like that. And one last thing. At Ravello System, we have a new feature that we call the Ravello repo. And what is Ravello repo? It's some kind of marketplace for the blueprint that our users, that we ourselves are creating. And let's say that if you want to have a look at how the Ravello sandbox look like, you can enter to this URL, and you will receive a Jenkins sandbox with all the plugins that I talked about today, all the configuration, all the tweaking. You will receive exactly almost identical Jenkins environment that we guys are using. So go for it, use it, and have fun. Mm-hmm. I will repeat the question. The question was, how can we manage the load when we are running the jobs on Docker host, because every Docker host have all the images. When you are running, when you are using Docker and Jenkins, and when you are using the Jenkins Docker plugin, in the configuration page, you have what we are calling a cloud definition. And then you are telling it to which Docker host it can work with, and which images are on which Docker host. And in the end, each Docker image receives a tag. When you are running your job, you can tell it, OK, so do you know the place when you are running a job that restricts where this job can run? So exactly at this place, you can give it the tag. And the tag that you will give it will point to the exact Docker host that you want to run the job on. OK, so thank you, guys, and good luck.